Session 108, so I'm hoping everybody's here for advanced assembly techniques using synchronous technology. Real quickly, and I say quickly because we got an hour and a whole lot of material to cover, and I'm going to make sure, as you can see here, that I got 35 minutes of demonstrations and have tried to cut as much fluff out of this as we can. So I'll spend a little bit of time and talk about what we're going to do, try to spend a little bit of time and talk about the solid edge capabilities. And then I'm going to get right into a live demo in Solid Edge and just show you this instead of PowerPointing everybody to death. So a little bit about myself. My name is Matt Johnson. I'm an application engineer with Ally PLM. We're VAR, actually located right here in Cincinnati. I've been using Solid Edge since version 9 in around 2000, so 12, 13 years now. And this time last year, I sat where most of y'all sit. I was a customer in the industry, so I've got about 8 years of experience with a large company of 100 seats of Solid Edge running in a managed team center environment. And about 3 years with a small family-owned business where I was the one and only Solid Edge user, CNC program, and all that bit. So I think that experience brings a lot of realness to what I did and what you all do. And I hope that you'll see that what I've chosen to adopt in the synchronous workflow can pay off for you guys. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in detail as we start to go through the demo. So this is Advanced Techniques Levering Synchronous Technology. Keywords here are synchronous technology, and some of us have held out longer than others. So what we're talking about today and all day is synchronous technology, and that's the approach we're going for. So want to make sure that we know that synchronous is a whole lot more than just a part modeling tool. Now, to take advantage of it in the assembly environment, we need to make sure that we have synchronous part models. But there's so much more that you're going to gain in your design process, particularly through a concept and revision cycle, if you're using the synchronous process. So I'm not going to read the slide to you here, but we're going to try to approach assembly level issues where we can talk about design intent. We're going to create, modify, edit features. We're going to find that we can do that faster, more fluidly with the synchronous environment. And I really hope that if you apply some of these principles, when you get back to the office, you'll find out that Solid Edge, really, as their tag phrase says, can really help you design better. And that's a little bit more than just a statement. I hope you'll find it to be true. This slide we do want to read. How many people have a real understanding of what we mean when we say top-down design approach? Show of hands. Okay, so I think most people have a general understanding of it, but to make sure everybody's on the same page, a couple key words I want to point out here. And let's start with bottom-up design, because we've all done that at some point in time. And even in a top-down design approach, you do steal a little bit of bottom-up. You'll go make a part and throw it in and then change your approach. But the key word for bottom-up design is a part-centric design approach. Bottom-up means you're building parts, and maybe three or four of you in your group are building parts. And you're going to, at the end of the day, try to bolt them together and pray they fit, all right? Top-down design approach is an assembly-centric design approach, where we're all referencing the same components with peer relationships as we build them. So we're building in the design intent by referencing that my part needs to be as big as and extend to the face of the part you're building, or my hole needs to be concentric to the hole that's already in this other component. So you've got a part-centric design approach, put them together and you hope they fit, or you build design intent into the model with this top-down approach. So, and the term really comes from just your assembly being the top level of your BOM structure, and you're working down through the BOM structure and building peer relationships into your part. So it's really, there's no science to it, it's top-down design. And we'll show you some examples of that. I believe the benefits of top-down design is twofold. One, you're going to have the ability to reduce errors because you're going to be building in this design intent. Like I say, if you're building parts bottom-up, people are building parts in a vacuum, and you hope they fit together at the end. So we're going to build in this design intent when we build parts and use these peer relationships. And the second is that since you've built these peer relationships, when you make edits, they're going to be faster and more cohesive and streamlined. You don't have to go back off and edit your part, and I have to edit my part. If you've ever had a stack of drawings on your desk at one point in time to edit an assembly, that was a bottom-up approach, and I've done it, right? So I know that I printed this part and made a model change in a note to myself and printed this part and made a model change, and then gone back and sat down at my desk and modified the two parts and gone back and tried again, right? Solid Edge has a number of capabilities that are going to help us do this. And this isn't going to flow necessarily with what we're going to present today. My goal for this slide was that when you get back to the office and you get the slide deck, that you can look at each one of these features through the help file or through tutorial and just remind yourself of some of the capabilities. Some of them will show, some of them we won't, but you can use sketches, and a top-down design approach is usually started with some sort of master layout sketch, an overall spatial zoning of your assemblies and your subcomponents. You can take that top-level assembly sketch and copy parts of it or all of it into part files. Those can be associative back to the assembly, or you can break those links, or if they're associative and you use them to create synchronous features, obviously we're going to drop the sketches anyway. Another one is using the assembly reference planes at the part level. This one's really helpful for people that are making plastic or casted parts, anything that's drafted faces on it. Anybody ever a part that's completely drafted and you try to assemble it in the assembly, and it just doesn't happen, right? Nothing's orthogonal to anything else. The real key here is if you do an in-place activate into a part at the assembly, if you hold the shift key, you can select the top level assembly's reference points. And it gives you a great place to start to build some of these features, and then you can relate things back in the assembly. Peer locate, and this is one, everything you see today in my demo will be in ST5. I'm running ST5, and I really wish I could have showed you peer locate in ST6. What you saw in the demo yesterday with the motorcycle handlebar was able to be done because we've changed the way that we locate peer references. And I'll point out what I mean by that when we do my demonstration. Inner part copies. Some people don't do inner part copies because they don't want that associative links of parts for file management. Some of you do. There's great benefits for both approaches. You need to know how you're doing your PDM system, how you're doing file management, and how careful you are about copying and renaming files and using Rev Manager and stuff like that. Face Relate, that's a synchronous tool that we have in the part environment to create face relationships, and we have it in assembly relationship as well to create relationships between additional components. Assembly-driven part features, those can be non-associative. You can simply punch a hole through a part, or you can keep them be associative. They can't be, they're going to be an ordered feature. So if you got a synchronous part and you punch an assembly feature through it, it'll actually be ordered in your model. And even though we're talking synchronous, it's the way Solid Edge does it right now. All you have to do is in place activate your model and say, transition that feature back to ordered, and you're good to go again. How many people do sheet metal design? Okay, if you're doing sheet metal design and you're not using synchronous, I think you're doing yourself a disservice. Some of us have been playing the waiting game on when to transition to synchronous because there's been a thought process involved when I build a part. Is my part mostly orthogonal, or am I going to have surfaces or sweeps? And we've had to choose kind of an approach. Since ST3, we can do both approaches, but in a sheet metal environment, I haven't found a situation that causes a problem for synchronous. I think sheet metal is an awesome tool to use synchronous. And the real benefit at the assembly level of the synchronous files, you can add flanges at the assembly without in-place activated into your sheet metal files. So we'll do one of those on the fly today to show you what we're talking about. Art talked earlier about some create and place options, replace part with copy and replace part with new part. We'll show you that dialogue real quick. And then the real benefit of the assembly select tool, which is the predominant part of the demonstration today, is how do we do multi-select? How do we select multiple components and edit them all at the same time, even if they're in different part files? And we'll use some face and part priorities with that, and we'll talk about that. And the steering wheel, and this is what our demonstration will be today. Some call it the assembly steering wheel. It's actually called the component select tool, but we'll get into that here in just a minute. So I wanted to make sure you guys had a reference point when we came back after this demonstration. We usually get slide decks after a conference like this, and you get through the slide deck and there's always a slide that says demo, and it's like, cool demo, right? But so if you go to our Ally PLM website, and there's a hyperlink here on the PDF you'll get, or if you search for Solid Edge SEU13 Advanced Assembly Replay, we've pre-recorded this same type of demonstration so you guys can look at it at the office and go through some of the techniques again. With that being said, I'll jump right into Solid Edge and we'll get started. Give me just 1 second here. This is a water-cooled supercomputer. I pulled it off of GrabCAD. It was a non-native solid edge file. So it came in as one of the neutral formats, either step or IGES or something. But you see, we opened it right here natively in solid edge. And just to clean up our display performance a little bit, not so much the performance, but just our visual, and this is what we got to do. I'm going to turn off some of those watered features. And everything in this file was native. The only thing that I created is this fan guard that you see here. I'm going to take you into that part file in just a moment and show you how I created it and how the synchronous features allow us to make some assembly edits. But most of what we're going to talk about today is this component select tool. You'll note that as I selected a part, I get the steering wheel. If I select my fan guard, I get a steering wheel. That's our component select tool. So if we go up to our select bar here, our select group on our toolbar, the tool that we're looking for is actually this little icon here. It's the part icon that's got a little vector coming out of the front face. So you'll note that if I toggle that off and I select my face, and some of you have done this because you've called tech support and said, hey, I don't want this steering wheel in my assembly, how do I turn it off? That's this little icon right here. When you go back to the office, turn it back on, all right? So we're gonna show you what it does and how to use it. So we wanna make sure that's toggled on. So now I get the steering wheel or the component select tool. And we'll take a look at what this does for us. I'm gonna just give us this fan guards and how it mounts. Steering wheel works the same way in the assembly that it does in the part environment. You can reorientate it, you can change its position. And what I want to start by doing is just placing this steering wheel at the center point of a known reference point. And that's going to be this mounting hole on this fan guard. Using shift and the tool plane, I wanted to change that into a plane that's normal to the way I want to move it. Because in the assembly environment, if I use this assembly select tool, I'm dragging this part, I'm moving this part. And what I should show you is that we've got assembly relationships on this part, and this part's fully constrained, even though I just moved it. So if we select the part and look at its assembly relationships, it's fully constrained. So I didn't drag it, I didn't break it, didn't do anything to it. Note that the mate relationship here is at 0, 0. And if I were to just drag this part up this way, you'll see that solid edge actually healed that relationship and just reset the offset value in there. So that's not really our intent right now, but just to show you the tool and how it works. We can take that a step farther by not just moving components, we can actually copy components while we do that. And I want to show you that some of this healing of relationships isn't necessarily a geometry-based thing, it's really a relationship-based thing. So even though this hole pattern happens to be the same, for the sake of demonstrating what we're doing here, I'm going to make this hole larger, certainly not 80. 8 would be good enough, right? And and we'll switch back over to move this part again. This time, instead of moving it, we're actually going to pull off a copy of it, and I want to show you where that command is for us, and then show you, or tell you at least, what the shortcut key I use is. Up here on our command bar, one of the options actually says move and copy. So if you were to toggle that down, you see it gets highlighted. That's now in the on or enabled position. If I were to drag this now, I'm going to get a new copy. I never really use that command though. It's extra mouse travel. I know that if I hold the control key down when I move the steering wheel, that tears off a copy. And that's the same in the part environment if you're moving a feature or features. So I'm going to hold down the control key and click my tool plane again. And now I'm peeling off a copy here. So I had my origin point at that mounting hole where I wanted it. I'm going to select my destination origin, which is that hole. And we'll note that what's happening here is I'm healing the relationships again. I'm doing it. Solid Edge is actually doing it for you. Regardless of the feature size, had nothing to do with the hole size. When I select my new fan guard, I have my axial line relationships and the mates that constrained this part originally. So we're fully constrained, and I haven't once gone in here and gone to my assemble commands and tried to pick new faces, new axis, and try to go through that step of aligning things. Sometimes I get a mate, sometimes I get a planar line and have to flip it, right? Solid Edge is doing that work for me. Let me tear off one more copy, and then we're going to take a look at the new options. And I say new, they were new in ST5 for, it's hard to click and talk at the same time sometimes, for create new parts. Bless you. Toggling the steering wheel in a 2D is the shift and click on the tool plane. that rotates it about its axis. What I want to do here, obviously this fan guard doesn't fit this larger fan down here. We need to make this bigger. This is where we're going to make a synchronous edit at the assembly level to the part. But if I were to do it now, I'd be editing all three fan guards, right? So what I want to do is come to the third fan guard, and I want to actually replace this with a copy. In ST5, we've got some new options. We've got replace with new part, and that's a great command. If you know that you need a part at the same origin as the part you're replacing, you're going to get a new part file where the other part's origin was, but a new clean data set to start with. Replace with copy I really like, because I used to do a save copy as and then have to come back in and do a replace. So this save part with copy is just kind of taking a step out of that process for me. It's a little more intuitive. So I'm going to say, hey, I need a copy of this part, leave it right where it's at. You notice that the command didn't go into the file save dialog right away. And that's great. Some people are actually getting tripped up by this. They're saying, hey, why do I got to hit this green checkbox? The reason is we've got new functionality in ST5. We can now select, and I say now, ST5 was released last year, but with ST5, you can select some of, but don't have to select all of similar parts to do a replace. So previously you could replace one screw or all 50 screws. You can now select, you know, 10, 12, 13, whatever the unique subset is you need to replace it. So this is the only part in my subset, and now my file save dialog comes up. For the sake of simplicity, we'll just call this the big fan guard. It's simple enough. As we write that to disk, I've got a new copy. It's already constrained. It's fully constrained in my model with living assembly relationships. What we want to do now is introduce a new concept and make an edit to this part. If you look at my cursor right now, there's a little orange box at the bottom of it. It's a glyph. And that glyph looks very much the same as the part icon box. I like to say that's a part priority. We have the option under our select tool again to do additional types of selection. So here's the part priority that I'm already in. You'll forgive me for my scribbles here. You'll notice that icon is very much the same as the part icon. The other option we have is to toggle to a face priority. So part priority selects the entire part in the assembly, as you always did if you had this component select tool turned off. But face priority allows us to pick faces of synchronous parts and make those part level edits at the assembly level. So let's bounce out of this, and if you hold over the select tool, it'll tell you how to toggle between these. You can manually come up here and say, I want to be in face priority. Now you'll notice the glyph on my keyboard is more of a plane representation, tells us we're kind of 2D face only. Or we can toggle back to part priority. Or we know that hitting control and spacebar, holding control spacebar, you notice that toggles that icon from face and part. And you'll get really used to this, because you're going to start to use it a lot, I hope, because there's a lot of benefit here. So I'm going to go to face priority, because what I need to do is select this face of the synchronous part, the pick-to-cylinder, and I've exposed the steering wheel, but I'm editing geometry in my part, and I'm going to simply make this edit by dragging this face out and picking the key point. Now there's going to be a lot of things happening here. Some of them are going to look unintended. I'm going to explain to you why that's happening, but I want to explain a lot of what's happening here. First, you'll notice that my edit happened what appears to be twice as much as it should have, and that's exactly what it did. And as we show you the part and how it was created, that'll make sense. The other thing you'll notice is that this part updated not only in size, but the pattern instance count. A great advantage of what you've heard other people say, use a hybrid modeling approach, or use synchronous when synchronous is best, use traditional when traditional is best. Let's take a look at how this part was created, and to do that I'm going to toggle back to part priority, and we're just going to edit this in place. And let's take a look at how it was built. You'll notice I do have a synchronous environment, and I do have an ordered environment. So let's roll back this model to the synchronous, and this is all that lives in my model that's synchronous. And what I did here was built a protrusion and then created a pattern about it. So if I did the same thing here and picked the cylinder, you'll see we're making the same type of edit. This is a really quick and easy synchronous edit that defines the overall shape and form of my part. That's a really quick and easy synchronous edit. What wasn't so easy, or was harder for me to constrain, was this pattern that I want to do, because in synchronous patterns, I don't have the ability to do this fit and define it between certain extents. So what I did with this pattern here, and we'll just take a look at the profile real quick, I'm able to constrain this to the center and say that the start of the pattern should always be 10 millimeters out from the center, But I want this pattern to grow, and it's, you notice it's connected to the outside of the cylinder. I want it to grow no matter how long this arm grows, and then I simply have, and we'll drag this for screen resolution, I simply have a fill pattern here. So no matter how long this arm grows, I'm always going to put a new instance in at 7.5 millimeters. So when I do my synchronous edit, my arm grows, my ordered feature takes over thereafter, recalculates, and gives me as many pattern instances as we need. That being said, let's let our model roll itself back out, and then we'll close and return. And I wanted to point out why our synchronous edit in the assembly made what appeared to be a double move. It's because we go back up here and look, and there's a pattern. So when I'm dragging the length of this arm, I'm actually making the edit to one arm, but since it's mirrored, there's two of them. So when you see something like that in assembly, there's no need to get overly concerned. We just need to understand how the part was built. We're going to do the same thing at the assembly level. We're going to pick this cylinder. And now I know that I just need to half my edit, whatever that is. So I'm going to go back to the key point again, and I'm going to allow it to calculate. That tells me it's 3467. I'm just going to override that, 3467 divided by 2. It'll make that edit for me. You'll see it's going to take a little bit of time, and what it did is it made the synchronous edit, and then the pattern calculated itself on top of it. So that quickly, we're able to make three components, place them, fully constrained assembly relationships, make an edit to one that needed to be a little larger, and I haven't really used anything other than the steering wheel. So if you've turned it off, I hope you'll see there's a little bit of value there, and I'm going to encourage you to turn that back on. Let's take a look at some other ways that we can use this exact same tool. This graphics card has a few open slots. The model I downloaded certainly wasn't complete, so let's make a few more copies of that. I'm going to go back to my part priority mode so that when I select this board, I'm getting the full component. And what you'll notice is that the steering wheel always shows up right where you click on that component. And I know that I'm going to use this as my key point to move my steering wheel. It makes sense to me that I don't really know how this part is positioned, but I know that relative to this corner of the socket, the board's probably going to be in the same position at every socket. So I'm going to zoom in so I can see. Select the component, get my steering wheel. I'm going to move the origin to the key point here. And then just like I did earlier, this is shift and click on the tool plane. I've got a 2D move here, and I'm going to hold down the control key, and I'm going to tear off a new copy of this. And something a little peculiar is going to happen, and I'm doing this to show you, because there's benefits to both of them. Let's zoom out here. I actually pulled off the whole subassembly. And if you remember, my select set was only that graphics card. There's an additional command when we use the component select tool. Let me move this up here so you all can see it. We're working with low resolution monitors this week. And it tells us we can move subassembly components within their occurrence. Now we know that right now we can't edit any subassembly parts location any way without opening it or doing an edit in place. I'm staying at the top level assembly. I'm going to activate this tool. And that tells me now, and just to show you without zooming in, now when I move this part, I'm simply moving the subcomponent within the subassembly. So that's extremely powerful. You can't do that any other way in Solid Edge that I'm aware of. If there is, somebody tell me. But let's show what this really does for us. Make sure that's still turned on. Pick a logical origin that I know I can replace on multiple instances. I wanted to change the orientation. Which box? This one here?
No, the one that you use.
This is your command bar. Am I correct on that? Give me just 1 second. Okay, so I click on this board. Oh, this right here?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. Move subassembly components. Is that what you were asking?
Yeah.
Okay, sorry about that. So I'm gonna place the origin right here. Shift space bar. Oops, that's not the orientation we need. It's already in the orientation. I'll tear off a copy here and place it. My steering wheel is gonna stay in the same place. I don't need to reset it. I'm gonna hold control down again, tear off a new copy. do it as many times as I need to. You probably need another one down here on the bottom. So I'll zoom in so we can see what we're doing. And again, I'm gonna tear off one last copy and go to this key point. Now we were editing a sub-assembly at the top level. Let's prove that by rolling down our Pathfinder. We don't have any new components underneath our fan guards at the top level. As we select this, here's our sub-assembly, and we'll take a look at what it consists of. We'll just in-place activate that. Here was our original board, this one here. And you'll notice that it has fully constrained assembly relationships, mate, mate, mate. They're all 0, 0, 0. We go to the next board, and you'll notice that I've got 0021. What we've done is Solid Edge has gone in there and just offset the value from its original location. If it can heal that, remember when I pulled the fan guard up, it just grew that value. Now when we moved the hole didn't move, and it couldn't heal, couldn't offset, it needs a new concentric relationship. That's being controlled by the options here, which I've turned off, and let me show you what those look like. Back on the fan guard, it'll be a little bit more intuitive to us. But now I've got fully constrained boards here at the sub-assembly, and I did that from the top level assembly. The options that aren't being showed, and I'll just tear off a new instance of this fan again. I'm waiting for the midpoint there, is the options here. And you'll notice I've checked this box that says, hey, remember this selection because I think I know what I'm doing. If I turn that off, this is what it's going to look like the first time you go back to the office and go to move something. You're going to pull off a copy, and you're going to click the destination point, and the command prompts you and says, okay, you've moved a component. I've got a few options we can do. One, you can tell Solid Edge not to do anything. You're going to place the component. It's going to be unconstrained and is what it is. But what we like Solid Edge to do is try to repair unsatisfied relationships. We have the option to adjust the offset values first. That's what I've got set. That's why that circuit board just changed that offset value. We can tell it to only offset, or we can tell it to only replace. I like to say, hey, go ahead and offset the values if you can, and if not, replace them to other components. So what happens after you select this option, our prompt bar tells us to select the components that we're going to find new relationships to. I was clicking through this earlier intentionally not to show you all, but here's what we're saying. We're saying I've got a select set that this fan guard needs to try to mate itself up to. It needs to heal these relationships somehow. I can tell it to go out and look at all other parts. Depending on how big your assembly is, you may not want to do that because it's going to try to find a relationship everywhere it can. I've got a display configuration right now. This might be healthy, you know, just if the parts are visible, you're allowed to try to heal to them. But if you typically will know what parts you know, you're trying to replace with. So I like to say, just with the selected parts, go find new relationships to the sheet metal file. And now when we accept that, that's when it goes out there and heals those relationships for us. Let's look at a couple options outside of just moving components, but how do we do interpart relationships with a synchronous assembly? And we talked that there's a real benefit of having interpart relationships. And then sometimes some people don't want to manage the links between those files, so you do not want interpart relationships. There's an option for both, and there's a benefit to both depending on what your design process is. But as we look at this circuit board, we'll note that it's got a series of mounting holes, but this center plate does not. I'm going to in-place activate into this part, and I'm going to steal the geometry from that circuit board simply by doing a project sketch. And we want that to live on the back face of this part. And I'm gonna just pick this entire face. And I've already got internal loops turned on, so that gives me exactly what I want. I'm gonna delete this outside boundary because we understand that the region concept in synchronous is any closed boundary. And so by leaving that box there, it's gonna make it a little harder for me for my select set. And all I really wanna do now is try to fence select just my holes. And if I can fence select just my holes here, I'll be able to cut these through this part. Now, I intentionally know I can't do this. I've also selected these planar faces on these slots. Since they're normal to the vector I'm getting ready to pull off, they can't create any geometry. And I'm simply gonna push those holes through the part. Close and return to the assembly. And now I've got a set of holes that I can mount my board to that are one for one. Question now comes in is what's going to happen when I do move this board. couple things happen. First thing you have to be careful of, this is the first, you know, the only careful I really have here. If you leave this subcomponent turned on, move subassembly components, you'll get undesired behavior. At this point in time, I'm really trying to say, hey, I want to move this circuit board to see if my holes stay in line. And you'll note that if I move this now, I'm moving the subcomponent, the board, the PCB from its components. That's not what we want, right? So you need to make sure on your toolbar here you've got that turned off. If we move this now, you'll note that those mounting holes do not, they're not associative. There's a couple ways to move them. The intuitive way to do that for me, or I mean not the intuitive way, the easy way, right, is to cheat and let's create those inner part relationships. Creating inner part relationships in the synchronous assembly is almost too easy. It really is. I mean, there's times that we're given command prompts that we try to guess about. This is one of the ones that's just like, oh, the command's done. So I'm going to run the command and just read my prompt bar. Click on the part or component that's to be driven. I want the holes on my mounting plate to be driven. Now my prompt bar says, click on the component that's driving. I said, well, I want my circuit board to always control the holes that are on my driven part. And the command's done. It's like, wait, what happened? Was it really that easy? Let's take a look at what happened in our part environment. In the synchronous environment, we went out, and you'll have to forgive me, I did not finish the command, I'm sorry. That's my driven part, that's my driving part. And what's going on here? What's that? No. Inner part relationships from this guy here to this guy here. Oh, you know what? I believe I moved this part. Let me delete this whole set. I moved them, and if they're not axial aligned, it won't go out there and find those for us. So I'm simply going to delete that whole pattern and recreate it. Give me just a second while I recreate these holes, and we'll see then that in the synchronous assembly, it'll go out there and find the relationships for us, and it'll build that feature. All right. It's my driven part. That's my driving part. And I've got an issue there that... Let me move on to the next feature and find out. I'll come back to you guys and let you know what's happening there. What Solid Edge will do is go into the part file, the driven part file, and it'll do inter-part relationships the way that we can do those manually in an ordered environment. We know that we can do an inter-part relationship. We can select the part that we want relationships from. We can select the face, and it'll bring a construction surface in. And then what it does within the part environment is creates relationships for us, these face relate commands, and it'll give us axial lines between all those faces for us. I talked about building design intent into our model when we build it. And one of the really slick things to do is making sheet metal components. So I'm going to pull off a little flange real quick because we need to mate this circuit board to something. I need to be in face priority again. If I'm in part priority, I'm selecting the component. Face priority allows me to pick this edge, and I'm simply going to pull off a new sheet metal flange. So I get my sheet metal command bar up here, and I'm going to say I do want a bend outside feature here, and I don't really know where I need this feature to be yet, how long it is or where it exists, so I'm going to you know, just drop it real quick kind of here in space. What I do know is that the intent is that I want to build in a 2 millimeter offset between this face and the back of this circuit board so that they never interfere. When you're using your steering wheel, and this is true for the part environment or the assembly environment, you can build offsets into it. So I've selected my face, which exposes this component select tool, hold down the shift key and pull off one of the axes, you're repositioning the origin of the steering wheel. So I want to put in my 2 millimeter offset here. So now my steering wheel is 2 millimeters offset from that face. This is the true design intent here. Now when I begin to move this face, I can pick the key point of that circuit board. And as we rotate our position up, you'll see that I truly have 2 millimeters offset in there. I didn't have to go in there and take a dimension, edit my part, edit the dimension of the flange, go back into the assembly, and take another dimension to check it. So this is that top-down design approach, building this intelligence in at the part level from the assembly. The next thing we want to do is on the same thing on this flange. Theoretically, we'd probably want a one-to-one here because there's a fastener going through here, but let's give it, you know, half millimeter just for manufacturing tolerance. I'm going to do the same thing. Click this face. Holding the shift key, we can drag this axis off, and I'm just going to say, give me a half a millimeter offset, and now when I begin to make this edit, I'll pick the back point of the flange, and now we've got, oops, I moved my steering wheel before we were ready to do that. And now you'll see that we've got a half a millimeter offset between these faces here. There's a few more commands on this bar that we haven't talked about, and I want to make sure we talk about each command on this component select tool. So let's walk through those real quick. We've talked about the first one, which was copy. We skipped the second one, went to the subcomponent tools. We've looked at the options, and I'm going to ask you when you go back to try these features to try and find out which one of these repair relationships is actually better for you and your guys' environment. These are, you know, part priority edits, part, you know, face tilt tip things like you do in the part environment. One we haven't talked about here is this move selected related faces. Let's look at this on the fan guards first, and then we'll come back on the circuit board, and it shows a little differently for both. I'm gonna scroll down here and turn on the other fan guards. And we noted earlier that if I select a fan guard and simply drag it up, I'm moving the fan guard because that's the only component I had in my select set, and Solid Edge is gonna repair that relationship. The other thing I can do is I can change from a part priority to a face priority, and I'm making a face priority edit on the sheet metal component. As I move that face up, it's logical that all the fan guards would go up because they're all mated to it, right? So I'm making a part level edit and bringing those up. But really the logic that my mind's going through when I'm making this edit is I have to move this fan guard. The fan guard is what I'm moving. But I want to make sure that the fan guard stays related to that back face. And by default, if the back face moves, then it's going to bring the other fan guards with it. We've got another tool on this command bar that says select related faces. So you'll note that the fan guard is the only thing in my select set right now. So when I say find related faces, Solid Edge went out and said, hey, there's a mate relationship between the bottom of this fan guard and this face. That face now becomes part of my select set. So now when I go ahead and pull this up, I'm getting a real similar edit to making the part level change, but I didn't have to know that that part was going to be affected by my change. I simply know that this fan guard, for whatever reason, needs to be moved out. And if it's mounted to or mated to another part, I need that part to come along for the ride. I don't need to think through that. That's what's going to happen for me. So that's another way to make those edits. Another example of that would be down on that graphics cardboard. Let's take a look at that again. Let's say you get these cards in or some other component. We've all bought catalog components before, right? And they come in at a different size. So let's say this board actually needs to be a little thicker. And therefore, the slot here in the pocket needs to be a little bit wider. I don't know how much. I don't know why. But if I select my board and I say pick the related faces, I'm going to do that again. You'll note that down here where it's mated, that these additional faces highlighted. I'm gonna lose the select set here intentionally. There's my board only. And when I select the related faces, Solid Edge has gone out and said, hey, I know that you're related to the inside of this pocket. If I leave that as is and begin to move this board out a little bit, because I know it's a little bit wider, I need to make a sub-assembly level edit here, right? I was moving the whole board. I want to edit just this component, and I'm going to move this thing out. Yep, we got to say select related faces, don't we, guys? Notice the other pockets are editing because they're, you know, three instances of the same part. So I'm going to make this 1 millimeter wider because my board's wider. And then I'm going to toggle this back over to face priority, and I'm going to select the face of my board, and I'm simply going to make it 1 millimeter wider. So now I got a board that was a little bit bigger. I didn't really need to interrogate my model and know how everything was built and what's related to what. I said, this board changes. I need to move it. And if you're associated to it and have a relationship to it, then go out and find it. And when I make my edit to my board, you go out and do what I need to do to my assembly. And then you can come back and make those part level edit changes on your board. So real powerful stuff here. And we've used the same command over and over again. We're using this assembly steering wheel that everybody's been afraid of, and it really does some amazing things for us. I talked about these relate commands a little bit in that PowerPoint, and you're going to want to look at these face relates here. These are your assembly relate, but the face relate commands, when you go back to the office, and you're going to want to play with these. These things are, I think, little magic buttons. They do things for you that you'd have to, remember that stack of drawings I had on my desk? You know, you'd go print a drawing out and realize I need to take a little bit of material off this one, add that one to this one. If we look at this board normal, we'll see that the slot here isn't completely lined up. And let's say the intent here is that the edge of the slot and the edge of the circuit board should be, you know, coplanar with one another. Well, that's exactly what face relates do for us. They give us geometric relationships like coplanar and concentric, symmetry, parallel, perpendicular, all these relationships that you can simply say, hey, I intend to have a coplanar relationship between the inside face of this, and I gotta pick the right face here, and the edge of my circuit board. And Solid Edge goes out there and makes those things in line. So now I've got that coplanar relationship between those two faces that was pushed out. Now this, at the top level assembly, those aren't associative, but we can still edit them at this point as if they were. And that's how we start going into select sets, and that's what we'll take a look at next.
Which part was changing when you did that?
You know, I'd have to take a look at it to see. Does the order of selection modify that? The first face moves to the second? Okay. So we need a hole to move this board, to mount this board to. And this is where peer relationships, peer locate on our toolbar here. In ST6 has changed dramatically, and I think this example is a pretty good example for us. We're going to do an in-place activate in here. And I need to punch a hole through here, so I'm going to go up and pick the hole command. And I want a hole that's in line with, I can't pick that tab, and we've all done that before. And so I gotta go create a sketch, and I'm gonna include this arc, because up on your toolbars here you have peer relationships turned on. And now that I've got my sketch, I don't even need my assembly anymore. I can kind of hide that and go back to my hole command. And now I'm able to pick that as the, you know, this key locate point for my axial line. So now I got a hole. We'll close and return. We'll look at our assembly. When we go to move these components, again, there's no relationship between these. If I move this up and down, you'll see that I've lost associativity with my hole. If you don't want to maintain those links of those inner part copies, this is where selection sets become more important. And note that you do have a selection manager in assembly. We've got a selection manager that's a little bit different than, quite a bit different really, than the part environment. So play with this and let it help you out by picking components. And you also still have the same good old fashioned component select tools up here, like pick all identical components and within a bounding box and that kind of stuff. So if I undo this so it's back at its home position and these are axial aligned, I want to move this board, but I also want to move, and I'm going to hold down my control key, and we've got to actually switch to face priority. So I had part priority on, picked the entire board, toggled to part priority, a face priority, hold down the control key and pick that key point. Let's see where I'm at. I mean, I do have that key point. And you'll notice now that I selected a face, my cursor now has this plus minus symbol. It's the same type of tool we have in the part environment where we can add only, subtract only, or add and remove. And we can toggle through that by simply hitting the space bar. So if I were going to be adding or removing additional faces to this select set, I could do that. This happens to be my select set. I'm going to zoom out so we can take a look what happens. And now I'm moving this board. And while I'm moving the board, since I included it in my select set, my hole goes along for the ride. I don't have to worry about breaking the axial line relationship. And there is no concentric relationship built in here at this point in time. We can certainly go back to that and do that, and they would stay aligned with each other while we did that. So anybody see some functionality here that they're not using that could be beneficial from the assembly environment? I see some heads nodding. So I'm going to encourage all of you to go back and turn this on if you've turned it off, right? And even, you know, I have it turned on and you click and you don't think about it. You just move on to what you're doing. But copying, particularly, think about it. You have a bolt stack. You got a bolt and a washer and a lock washer and a nut. And that's kind of all kind of a sub-assembly or a group. Pick that whole thing as a select set. Do a control and drag off. Pick another hole. And you can just keep picking instances of your holes and place that whole fastener stack. That by itself pays for your price of admission, right? So let's bounce back over to this PowerPoint, because we all love PowerPoints, right? Okay. Let's review the benefits that I hope you agree with. These are the same ones I told you about when we started here. You always hate to pick graphics for a slide deck, but I think these really talk really well about the benefits of top-down design approach. You've got components in an assembly that are already defined. This gear train, is already defined, and we need to build this red gear, and it has to fit, has to mesh. It can only fit in one location for this gear train not to lock up, right? It has to be in the right vertical, horizontal location, and be the right size. Now, any three of those can change, but they have to change relative to the gray gears. They can't change. The other thing is you're working on a project team, all right? You've got a top-level kinematic assembly that has to function. You're responsible for the top of it, you're responsible for the bottom of it, and somebody's responsible for the mechanism that moves in between it. And if you're not working on these things in relationship with peer relationships with one another, you're going to build something that you can't bolt to, right? And so we need to make sure we're including faces and using these synchronous tools at the assembly and build in design intent. That's kind of the whole key here, is that we're building in the design intent. And then we got these three guys that come along. We're going to create design intent. You're going to edit it. But while you're editing it apart, you're able to maintain the design intent. Typically we edit a part and you break design intent. You got to go back and fix the second part. And by fixing both of them, you rebuild design intent. Let's never break it to begin with. We're going to create and maintain it, edit it at the same time. And you can obviously verify it with tools like we did by offsetting the steering wheel before we even make an edit. And you can kind of build that in. And I believe even when we do make the edits, they'll be more intuitive and they'll be quicker in the amount of time it takes us to do that. So, how to learn more. I think Nike said it right. Sometimes we just got to do it, all right? There's new tools out there. You just got to go back and do it. We've played this game for 5 releases now of all synchronous is new and we don't want to learn it. And half of you have, half of you haven't. And I'm going to really encourage you, if it fits the models that you make, to try to use it. And there's some approaches we can take to do that. If you haven't gone through the Solid Edge tutorials, you really need to do that. There's some great examples in there on how to model parts, how to model assemblies, and some of these advanced techniques wouldn't necessarily be found in tutorials, but there is self-paced training available online. And Siemens is actually starting to record audio over that. So they're not just videos, but they're demonstrations, a little computer animated voice. Ally PLM hosts lunch bites once a month. Those are on the different Siemens products that we provide. So majority of the time they're Solid Edge. We do drop NX and other things in there as well. But feel free to stop by on your half an hour for lunch and watch our lunch bites. You can also go to our website and search any lunch bites or any tutorial videos we've ever produced. They're out there for free. Go to allyplm.com and you can search those. And that's also where I'm going to host the replay video of today. And you'll be able to see properly. Remember, I had that glitch in the inter-part relationship. That's already been pre-recorded, and it's already out there on the website. So I promise I wasn't lying about it, right? I just goofed up as we were moving through here. Ally PLM Classroom Training, we're not here to sell you anything, but we are definitely here to support you. If you want to start to apply in these tools and you want to speed up your, you know, the time it takes you to learn that, we'd be more than happy to walk you through that in a classroom setting. We also offer that online now for any users who maybe can't travel to our corporate office. It's all instructor-led. You'll basically dial in remotely with a class that's in session, and we'll share your monitor and you'll share our monitor, and we'll walk through that together with you. YouTube, new in ST6, did you guys pick up on that? That there's an embedded YouTube recorder and player. What they didn't mention so much about it is when you screen capture these things with YouTube, it's gonna tag, kind of smart tag your videos for you. So if you're in the assembly environment and you're in ST6, and I go search YouTube for ST6 assembly tips, it's gonna find your videos because they've been pre-tagged. Now we should add additional tags, right? And say part edits or whatever to help people find those, but learn it, test it, trust it. You're not gonna go back to the office today and do all this stuff because maybe you didn't follow along completely, and even if you did, you're like, yeah, I don't know that cat. He don't really know everything he's talking about, right? So start simple. Open up the training files. You all know, or you should know, that in your SolidEdge install folder, so if you go to, you know, C program files, ST5, there's a folder called training. It's got a bunch of sample files out there for you. Open those up. If you break those, what's it really matter, right? So practice these techniques where you can. Make sure they're synchronous part files and go from there. Then you're going to want to test it. You don't have to start on your company's top level model. All right, pick a subassembly. Pick something that you really know that if something goes wrong, you would know it, right? Use a smaller 3 or 4 or 5 part subassembly. Try these things. And as you start to see how they work, then you're going to take that up another level in your assembly, and you're going to start doing these subcomponent edits, and it's really going to pay off. And then as you begin to trust it, I really think that you're going to leverage the power of these type of things, and you're going to see your productivity and your speed go up. And really, I think we all can be better designers, right? I'm going to encourage everybody to get involved. You're going to share information with users at your own company. You're going to share information online with either YouTube or the PLM community, and certainly with local user groups. Here in Ohio, we hosted 4 user groups this year. We had close to 35 users at most, if not all, those groups. And a number of you have stood up and said, hey, I'm willing to definitely be involved in those, and I'll even help you lead those and provide some content. So. Let's share information with each other. You know, just because I've done something for 10 years doesn't make it the right way. You know, you might have found something out through the School of Hard Knocks that I would really like to learn without having to fall on my face trying to do it, right? And we can share that information with each other. Time to upgrade. Maybe not your software, but the way of doing things, right? So ST1 was a long time ago. ST3 is going to be dropped in support when ST6 comes out, right? No, ST3 is, you know, so we're always 2 versions, or 1 version back, so current and back. So let's learn what we're doing and share that with others. So I really thank everybody for coming. I've saved 5 minutes for questions and answer, which was really my intent here, but I thank you for coming and taking time. And don't run out quite yet. I'm gonna advance one slide. Well, Ally PLM wanted to make sure that this was more than just a presentation for y'all. We really do wanna help you all design better. So we went out and took some synchronous tools and created a cheat sheet for you and printed these on a mouse pad. So if you're going to take these back to your office and really use them, we want to help you do that. So before you leave, some of our application engineers will be back at the end of, back of the door, and we'd love to give that to you. All right. So let's roll back, and I'm available for any questions. And there's a couple other guys in the room that I'll hit up if I don't know it. So anything you saw today or any questions? No? Okay.